So we welcome everyone on the occasion of Gita Jayanti, Srimad Bhagavad Gita Ki. So, the Bhagavad Gita was spoken by Krishna to Arjuna when Arjuna was experiencing a great confusion. Arjuna was extremely skilled, and Arjuna was one of the most expert warriors. So all of us have been given certain abilities. All of us want unlimited ability to consume, to enjoy the resources of material nature. All of us have unlimited desire to control the material nature and objects of this world. All of us have unlimited desire to convince others about our viewpoint and establish the superiority of our viewpoint over others. And all of us have unlimited desire to actually establish the superiority of our plans. And we have unlimited desire to establish our ability to compete and conquer over others. But the fact of the matter is, although we have unlimited desire to consume, to control, to convince, and to compete, but we have only limited ability to do so. And therefore, we spend our entire life trying to control our circumstances around us, but we have limited ability to control our circumstances. And Krishna is revealing that through the example of Arjuna, who was amongst those who had tremendous ability to control the circumstances around him. He had all the facets available to him. But a situation arose where Arjuna became totally helpless. And then Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita to reveal that in such circumstances, one can only control one's consciousness. So that the ability to control our circumstances is limited, but the ability to control our consciousness is unlimited. And therefore, Arjuna, the great Kshatriya warrior, who had the swabhava of a Kshatriya, who had the swadharma of a Kshatriya, and who also had the training under Dronacharya as a Kshatriya. So we have our nature, we have our training, and then we have our occupation. And the biggest challenge in the modern times is matching all the three. That one may have a certain nature, one may have a different kind of training, and one's occupation may be somewhere else. And therefore, a person is more likely to be confused, disoriented, depressed, and not knowing actually what he is supposed to do in this circumstance. But Arjuna's case was not like that. Arjuna had the nature of a Kshatriya, had the training of a Kshatriya, and Arjuna's occupation was that of a Kshatriya. And Arjuna had gone through these kind of situations millions of times before. He was on a battlefield. And Arjuna knew it like the back of his palm. But Krishna just introduced a little deviation, a little change, a little variety. And Krishna brought Arjuna right in front of his teacher and his grandfather. And as soon as Arjuna sees his teacher and grandfather, Arjuna becomes totally overwhelmed, because Arjuna knew what a battle is. Arjuna knew how to fight a battle. So Arjuna was expert as a warrior. But at that moment, Arjuna's skill could not help him, because that situation was organized by Krishna in a way that Arjuna started thinking, I know what a battle is, I know how a battle is fought, but I am suddenly confused, why should I fight this battle? And therefore each one of us will go through such situations in life where our entire life's training, our entire life's expertise and skills may be with us, but they may not help us actually execute the duty on hand. And that is known as the dharma sankat, which Arjuna expresses to Krishna as karpanya dosho patha svabhava prichhami tvam dharma sammudha. So dharma sammudha means conflict and confusion about one's duties. And why does that conflict and confusion about one's duties arise? It is because in the material sphere, all of us have multiple identities. And therefore, based on the identity, we become absorbed in a particular line of duty. So Arjuna's identity as a warrior would make him pick up the Gandiva, put the arrows, choose the right astras, and kill the opponent and be victorious. That would be the call of duty when Arjuna had the identity as a warrior. Now Arjuna saw in front of him Bhishma, the grandfather. So suddenly Arjuna remembered his identity as a grandson. And as the duty of a grandson, he's supposed to offer affection, love, loving embraces, appreciation for the grandfather. And so Arjuna is thinking, now how do I reconcile my identity as a grandson with my identity as a warrior? As a warrior, I am supposed to kill, but as a grandson, I am supposed to express love. And then he looks at Dronacharya, and then he remembers his identity as a student. And as a student, he is supposed to express gratitude, appreciation, remember that whatever power he has is simply by the grace, the training, the nourishment of Dronacharya as the guru. So this is another identity, and Arjuna has duties as a disciple related to that identity. And therefore, Arjuna experiences a great confusion due to clash of multiple identities which seem to contradict each other. And so, although Arjuna's swabhava was defined, Arjuna's swadharma was defined, Arjuna's expertise did not help him in this situation, and Krishna had to speak the Bhagavad Gita to explain to Arjuna that when multiple identities at the level of one swabhava and swadharma conflict, which they inevitably will, one has to rise above all of that and come to another level of one's swarupa. And therefore Krishna spoke the Gita to reveal to Arjuna that I will now reveal your eternal identity, which will take you above all conflicting identities, and that identity will never change, it will remain eternal, and it will be the cause of your great peace. So change creates crisis, and permanence creates peace. And therefore, To the extent we identify ourselves with changing identities, to that extent, we are always in anxiety. And therefore, each one of us is used to certain identities within this material world in our limited sphere of experience. And we are struggling hard to maintain those identities. And by the influence of the time factor, by the influence of circumstances, by the influence of forces of this world, as those identities start changing, we struggle and fight hard to maintain those identities. And the attempt to try to maintain those illusory, false, heroic semblance of our real self. We try to be the false heroes of this world. And that becomes the cause of unending anxiety. And this is reflected in the Mahabharata through the character of Karna, that who had an illusory identity of himself as a great warrior who would sacrifice and be the martyr, one who has always been subjected to injustice, and he just could not come out of that illusory identity because he had become so attached to that illusory reflection of his real self, that people in this world, they prefer to suffer the known than risk the unknown. And therefore to transform and change that identity was impossible for Karna. Even though Krishna, who represents the Guru, and Kunti Maharani, like the mother, who represents the Shastra or the Vedic literatures, all the knowledge, were revealing to Karna his real identity. But till you realize that identity, it is like the unknown. And therefore people are afraid to risk the unknown. They would rather suffer the known. And therefore Karna went through unlimited suffering until the very end, could not offer himself in submission to Krishna. And that was the difference between Arjuna and Karna. That in the situation of great crisis, Arjuna managed to actually take shelter of Krishna. Arjuna managed to transform his despair and his dejection into something positive. And sometimes when misery comes in gradual stages, we become conditioned to that misery. We are able to absorb that misery. When shock is given in limited amount over a long period of time, and there is sufficient intermittent gap between when the misery and the shocks are administered, one develops immunity against those shocks. One develops the ability to deal with that misery without actually feeling the need to overcome that misery. So sometimes we only wake up when the despair or the misery is given intensely and suddenly. So that is what Arjuna experienced on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. That Arjuna went through that complete transformation because the situation was created by Krishna very suddenly and with great intensity. And so Arjuna woke up and he wanted to find a solution to that. And Arjuna became completely overwhelmed with dejection, thinking that my entire existence in this material world on the platform of material occupational duties is that of a warrior. I am known as the expert warrior. And with my expertise, I can destroy both of these personalities. At least I can try my level best to destroy them. But I don't see the point because I don't want to do it. And therefore, Arjuna became totally confused because he had the skill, but he lost the will. And so in modern times, the education system is focusing more on increasing and enhancing people's skill. And transcendental knowledge and philosophy is to help us understand the purpose. And when you understand the purpose properly, then you have the right will to negotiate various complications which will come in the journey. To be able to deal with multiple identities and then synthesize them as Jivera Swarupoi Krishner Nityadas. And only after the synthesis of that identity, we can surrender that identity in submission to Krishna's lotus feet. And therefore, this entire Bhagavad Gita begins with Arjuna's Vishad. And so the first chapter of Gita is called Arjuna Vishad Yoga. And why it is called Yoga? Yoga means to come closer. So, this Vishada, it helped Arjuna in a situation of despair. So, yoga actual meaning is also means. So, the despair or the suffering condition and the lamentation of Arjuna became the means by which he started seeking a solution. So, therefore it was yoga in that context. And it is yoga in another context because thanks to that, Arjuna started seeking solution from Krishna. He approached Krishna. He came closer to Krishna and heard knowledge from Krishna. So that was bringing Arjuna closer to Krishna. So therefore, that Vishada became yoga. So therefore, the Bhagavad Gita is the ultimate cure for this dejection. And so in the Bhagavad Gita, we find that various shlokas describe the names of Krishna and Arjuna. And today in my talk, I'm going to be focusing on, some of these names. What those names mean and how it reflects qualities of Krishna and Arjuna and what we learn from them. So generally in the material world, the basis for a name is either culture or relationship, or it could be based on a social status. But when we refer to Krishna's names, then Krishna's names are on the basis of his janma, karma, guna and rupa. His birth, his activities, his qualities, and his form. And therefore, the characteristics of Krishna is that Krishna's holy names are eternal, they are non-different, they are relishable, and causes liberation. Ata Sri Krishna Namadi na bhavet grahyam indriyai sevon mukhehi jivado swayameva sphuratyada. Nama Chintamani Krishna Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha Purnushuddho Nityamukto Abhinatvam Nama Namino. So therefore it is Nama Chintamani, it is eternal, it is non-different Abhinatvam, it is Rasa Vigraha, relishable, and it is Nityamukto. It causes liberation. So therefore, these names of Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, they depict Krishna's qualities. Then, they indicate the nature of the friendly relationship between Krishna and Arjuna. When we go through a difficulty, then what really helps us come out of that difficulty is knowledge. But what is the basis of transmission for that knowledge? Trust. And unless there is trust established, one cannot have the sufficient bandwidth to establish the relationship. Through the relationship only, the knowledge and the solution and the help will flow. So that's an extremely important principle. And so, the relationship between Krishna and Arjuna is friendly. It indicates that the trust level was very high. And the analysis of the names along with the philosophy and the meanings makes the study of the Gita very relishable. And therefore, these names and the meanings of those names, the same name comes in different verses, which indicates that the the name of the Krishna or Arjuna is same, but the context in which that name is used is referring to another mood. So the flavors are changing, the moods are changing. And therefore, many people feel that the study of Bhagavad Gita is a very, very difficult philosophical exercise and it's not for us. It's very heavy. Just the size of the Gita is overwhelming. We become bewildered. When I was in IIT, one of my friends' rooms, I saw the Bhagavad Gita as it is. I had just started coming to satsang. And I had not preached to him. And I was wondering how he has the Gita in his room. And I asked him, why you have the Gita? And he said, you know, many times because of anxiety, I'm not able to sleep at night. When I start reading this, within few moments, deep sleep. I said, who told you that? No, I went once to the program and then I experienced it. So I got the Gita with me. So the purpose of Gita is not to put us to sleep, but to wake us when there is pain surrounding us and to know how to convert that experience of pain into real pleasure. So we have the sheets which we have Xerox, so we could also chant the verses which we are referring to. We don't have too many, but you can distribute the copies, some in ladies' side also. So the first name which we will discuss of Krishna is Achyuta. And right from the first chapter, 21st verse, 1.21, it is described. Senayor ubhayor madhyer ratham sthapaya mechyuta yavadaksha nirikshaham yodhu kamana vasthitan. You can give one to me also. So here Arjuna is referring to Krishna as Achyuta. So Achyuta here in this verse means one who never fails in the affection for his devotees, which is a very famous, you know, meaning given by Srila Prabhupada also, which refers that here Achyuta means Krishna is affectionate. It refers to his affection to his devotees. Bhakta Vatsal. So Vatsala comes from the word Lati. Lati means to bring. Vaksha refers to chest. When you have something precious, you pick it up and keep it close to your chest. So Vatsala means, Bhakta Vatsala means Krishna loves his devotees so much, he picks up the devotees and places them close to his chest to protect them, to show that they are so dear to me. So that is the meaning of Bhakta Vatsala. So therefore, this is a very important definition that he never fails in the affection for his devotees. So in the 10th canto of Bhagavatam, the Vrajavasi is referred to Krishna as Bhakta Vatsala. Krishna Krishna Mahabhaga Tom Natham Gokulam Prabhotratum Arhasi Devana Kupitat Bhakta Vatsala. That my dear Lord, you love your devotees so much. You cannot fail us. And therefore we are in this difficult situation. Help us. Like that. So their intense cry of the Brajavasis is in intimate terms. They are not considering Krishna to be Supreme Personality of Godhead. They just feel that he is our most intimate well-wisher. Then the second verse which refers to Krishna as Achyuta is in the 11th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So we'll chant together. Yacha vasartham asatkritosi viharashayasana bhojaneshu ekothavapyachyuta tatsamaksham tatkshamayetva mahamaprameyam. So here, when, you know, Krishna has spoken the 9 chapters, then Arjuna wants to hear about Krishna's power, opulences, glories. And so Krishna starts describing one after another in the 10th chapter. I am the splendor of the sun, of the moon, I am this, I am that. And then finally he says, yad yad vibhuti mat sattvam shrimat urjitam eva. Whatever power you see in this world, opulence you see is simply a spark of my splendor. So having described all this in words, then at that time, Arjuna wants to hear and know more. So Arjuna has heard everything about his opulences and power. But Arjuna wants to see also. Saying audio is not sufficient. I want video. I want a full audio video presentation. Then Krishna demonstrates and displays the Virat Rupa. So when he displays the universal form, then Arjuna is finally convinced. And then Arjuna becomes fearful that, oh my God, I dealt with him in so many ways, I did not even know. So many times you may not see the power of somebody. It may not reflect immediately. But Arjuna was dealing with Krishna as an intimate friend. And then when he saw this, Arjuna is thinking, now, what all I did to him, is he going to be angry with that? So therefore he is expressing here. So he recalls his offenses. So he's saying, Tat kshamaye tvam aham apramayam. So he's referring to Krishna as Achyuta. And here it means, my dear Lord Krishna, although I committed so many offenses towards you, you are so affectionate to me that your affection will definitely cause forgiveness to rise in your heart. And I am very confident that as your affection is infallible, your forgiveness will also be infallible. So this refers to Krishna's quality of being forgiving. Then another verse in which Arjuna refers to Krishna as Achyuta. Arjuna uvacha nashto moha smritir labdha tvat prasadatmaya achyuta. Sthitosmi gata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. So this Arjuna says that, well, my illusion is destroyed. I have regained my memory. Tvat prasadat maya, by your grace. Sthitosmi, I am situated in a consciousness which is beyond doubt. Gata sandeha. I am ready to act. And I had taken a vow to Draupadi, that I will destroy all the Kauravas. I will protect you and I will actually seek revenge. And on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, when I forgot about that vow, forgot about that duty, my head started reeling, my hands and legs were trembling. If I had succumbed to that and not decided to fight this battle, it would be a great sin in giving up my vow. So therefore, that would have been extremely, extremely sinful. So I am grateful to you that you have protected me from breaking my vow. So therefore here he says, Achyuta, tvat prasadat maya chuta. That as a master, you will never allow your servant to fail in the performance of their duty. You will never allow your servant to break their vow. So you are so concerned about them. And therefore, maya chuta. I would have given up my duty. I would have given up my vows. You protected me. You are achyuta. You never fail to intervene in such situations. So therefore, here achyuta refers to Krishna, who protects the promises of his devotees. And therefore, Krishna consciousness begins with our commitment to Krishna, that we start to follow all these activities and principles. So in the Sakshi Gopal pastime, many people feel how this Sakshi Gopal pastime found its way into the Chaitanya Charitamrita, because it appears to be just a young man wanting to get married and he gets connected. And then he is aspiring for that marriage, and so he drags in Krishna also. How desperate he is, that he is not just satisfied with what's going on in society, he is willing to bring in Krishna as a witness. So this appears to be a karmakanda exercise. But what's the real intention? The real intention is the younger Brahmana is concerned with the vows taken by the elder Brahmana in front of the deities. And he feels that the elder Brahmana has taken vows in front of the deities, and if he is unable to keep up that vow, he will go to hell. And therefore it is my duty to pray for him, protect him. And therefore he travels all the way from Vidyanagar to Vrindavan to protect the older Brahmana from committing the sin of breaking his vow. Evake Ache Mura Sakshi Mahajan Yaravakya Satyakuri Mane Tribhuvan. And the younger Brahmana says, I agree. I don't have wealth. I don't have high education. I am not coming from such a high class Brahman family as you. I don't have any material opulences. I don't have any material assets. I agree. But I have one asset. I have only one asset. And if anyone has that one asset, all other assets follow. What is that asset? I have faith in the words of Krishna. And therefore, I am going there. Because I have faith that if Krishna comes and gives his witness, everyone will hear and understand. So Prabhupada writes in the purport that he went to America with no assets. But he had only one asset. Faith in the words of Srila Saraswati Thakur. So the faith in the words of the Vaishnavas and the devotees and the instruction and order of the devotees, having faith in that is a greater asset than all other assets of this world put together. So therefore, this pastime reveals that, and the Lord is so concerned that my devotee should not break his vow. The deity walks all the way, showing how I care for my devotees. Achyuta. I am infallible, and I will, if really with great care and concern someone prays to me, my heart melts and I start walking. I cannot resist to see my devotee in a suffering condition. So therefore, the Lord is described here by Arjuna as Nashto moho smritir labdhvatpat prasadat mayachyuta. You protected me from committing the sin of deviating from my duty and my vows. Then we have Krishna, who is referred to as Anagha. Shri Bhagavan uvacha lokesmin dvividha nishtha pura prokta maya anagha jnana yogena sankhyanam karma yogena yoginam. So here in the third chapter, Krishna is describing to Arjuna in response to Arjuna's question, which is better, jnana is better or karma is better. So he's saying that, my dear Arjuna, this is a very subtle subject matter, and you can appreciate and understand this because you are qualified. What is your qualification? You are anagha, sinless. So Krishna is revealing that spiritual subject matters are subtle. And to absorb and internalize spiritual subject matters, one needs qualification. And what is that qualification? One of the prime qualification is one has to be sinless, anagha. So that is described here, that Arjuna is sinless, and because he is sinless, he can do two things. He can grasp the spiritual knowledge, and number two, he can discriminate the subtle differences between the two paths. Dvividha nishtha pura prokta maya anagha. Jnana yogena sankhyanam karma yogena yoginam. You can appreciate the subtleties, the differences. Why? Because you are sinless. Like that. So someone approached Prabhupada. Like Prabhupada used to have many debates in Mumbai. in the initial days, so many well-wishers, you know, Indian businessmen, they would come and start discussing. It is interesting that Prabhupada has more than 5,000 disciples, but he hardly had 10 devotees from India whom he initiated here, who got connected to him, like Indians, 10 to 20, hardly. And at that point, nobody could imagine that ISKCON in India is going to flourish so much. And mostly, so Prabhupada had many disciples across the world, but he had, you know, some of the most interesting and prolonged debates in India, especially in the morning walks on the Juhu beach. And, you know, 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th of January, ISKCON Juhu is celebrating and inviting everyone for their 40th anniversary of creation and installation of Shri Radharas Bihari temple. And Prabhupada, every morning, would go for a walk. And one of the events planned is a morning walk at Juhu Beach. Of course, in 71, 72, it was much more peaceful than now. But devotees are still thinking and planning how to make it as Krishna conscious as possible in the current scenario. But Prabhupada's morning walks, if you hear, there would be so many debates, questions, discussions. So one life member, he approached Prabhupada, and Prabhupada then started asking him, you know, so you claim you have studied Gita. Yes, I have studied Gita. So Prabhupada said, which is your favorite verse? And he said, when Krishna says, you know, to Arjuna, yathechasi tatha kuru. Whatever you like, you do. That is the essence of the Gita. So this is practically the dream of every conditioned soul, that one can live one's life whimsically. Right? And then when people would come and tell him, any path you take, it will all go to him only. So Prabhupada would say, why Krishna has to speak Bhagavad Gita? If ultimately anything you do, you go there, why he has to waste his hour, 1 hour speaking this? So therefore, sinless means when we actually follow the principles, then we start understanding the subtle nuances of this philosophy. Otherwise, many times you keep reading, but you can't penetrate, you can't understand. And many people I know, they say, you know, I start reading, then I forget which chapter I was reading. Then I start reading again, then I think, oh, probably I read it yesterday. You know, everything looks same. Every shloka, every chapter, Nishkam Karma Yoga, Karma Yoga, action in Krishna consciousness. So, when we become more and more sinless, to that extent we'll be able to absorb this. 14.6 is another verse on Anagha. Tatra sattvam nirmalatvat prakashakam anamayam sukha sangena badnati jnana sangena chanagha. So here Arjuna has been given the assurance that, okay, modes of material nature is the chapter topic. So my dear Arjuna, I assure you that you will not be under the influence of the mode of passion and ignorance, because you are anagha, you are sinless. And therefore, you also know that you should fight this battle. You have been sinless, and even if you fight this battle is not going to entangle you under the modes of passion and ignorance, because I am telling you to fight. So therefore, this fight will not create bondage. You will remain sinless. Sukha sangena badnati, jnana sangena cha anagha. So the mode of goodness is something which takes you beyond the modes of passion and ignorance and creates the platform where spiritual knowledge can be experienced like that. So one time Ravana approached Narad Muni, and Ravana demanded from Narad Muni, give me spiritual knowledge. So Narad Muni looked at him and said, you are not qualified. Ravana became very angry. He said, no, I am the king. I am learned in so many other scriptures. Give me transcendental knowledge. And Narad Muni said, sorry, you are not qualified. Ravana took out a sword and kept it at, you know, Narad Muni's neck and said, I will kill you. Narad Muni said, this proves you are not qualified. This is not how you respond. So Ravana took that sword and tried to kill Narad Muni. Because Narad Muni's body was Satchidananda, the sword went through and through. Ravana was even more bewildered. All his 10 heads were bewildered. And Ravana had never seen something like this. Ravana said, whenever I try to kill someone, I am successful. This sword went through and through. What body you have? He said, I have a spiritual body. Ravana said, I want also. Because that was Ravana's, you know, you considered the whole world like a mall. Whatever he liked, you would pick up. And never pay the bill. So that was Ravana's consciousness. So when Narad Muni heard this, he said, oh, that is very simple. Just take shelter of Lord Ram. Ravana said, ah, that I can never do. That is impossible. So therefore, unless one becomes sinless, one cannot come to the stage of mode of goodness. Until one comes to the mode of goodness, one cannot absorb transcendental knowledge. Okay, next. 15.20. Iti guhyatamam shastram idam uktam mayanaga etad buddhva buddhiman syat kritakrityascha bharata. So here, it is described iti guhyatamam shastram. Right? Because if anyone asks you, like I ask many people, are you buddhiman or you are buddhihin? You are buddhiman or you are buddhu? You are intelligent or you are not intelligent? And everyone say, oh, I'm intelligent. I said, okay. Then do you know the 15th chapter? Bhagavad Gita? I said, no. So Krishna says, who is intelligent? One who knows the first 19 chapters of the 15th chapter. First 19 verses of the 15th chapter. Iti guhyatamam shastram idam uktam mayanaga. What I have spoken in this chapter, etat buddhva, once you know that, buddhiman syat. So at least if other chapters we don't read, at least 15 chapter we can read. And therefore Krishna has kept it very small also. 20 verses only. Buddhiman syat kritakrityascha bharata. So therefore he is saying that in the previous four verses he was describing about the knowledge of Purushottam Yoga, Kshara, Akshara, this, that. And he says the knowledge of the Jiva, the knowledge of the Paramatma and the relationship between them and the relationship with their material energy. So the Jiva, Paramatma, Prakriti, this is so rare, it is concealed. Iti guhyatamam shastram. This knowledge is concealed. It is password protected. It will only be revealed to someone who is qualified. So you need qualification to access it. And therefore he says, etat buddhvan buddhiman syat. So, maya anagha, O Arjuna, because you are qualified, because you are sinless, so I am revealing this Purushottam knowledge to you. That means even to be a recipient of that knowledge, you have to have qualification. Like that. Next, Krishna is also known as Arisudana. Arjuna uvacha katham bhishmam aham sankhe dronam cha madhusudana ishubhi pratiyotsami pujarhav Arisudana. So here, Arjuna is referring to Krishna that you are the killer of demons. So if you, in your own life, in your own pastimes, we have heard that you killed demons, how you are expecting me to kill my own grandfather and my own teacher? You have never killed any of your loving associates before. There is no track record. You killed Kamsa, your uncle, but everyone knows how much love you had for Kamsa, right? Kamsa sent so many toys to play, like Mama sends toy to Bhanja. But Bhanja broke all the toys. He returned back all of those, killed everyone. So where is the record? So therefore Arjuna is asking this question, that please do not engage me like this. Puja, Rahav, Arisudana, they are all supposed to be worthy of my worship. And those who are worshipable, you are asking me to kill them? How can I do that? So Arjuna is protesting. Next. Matra sparshastu kaunteya shitoshna sukha dukkhada agama apai no nityas tam titikshasva bharata. So in this verse, Krishna is calling Arjuna by two names, Kaunteya and Bharata. That Arjuna, what is the cause of our distress? The cause of our distress is very simple. Our senses come in contact with sense objects. When the senses come in contact with sense objects, we expect every interaction of the sense with the sense object to create pleasure. That expectation of pleasure, when the sense interact with sense object, that expectation is the cause of our frustration. So if you are expecting in advance that some interactions will create pleasure, other interactions will create pain, that gives you the power to tolerate. So that's an important, you know, factor. So therefore, here he is saying, Matra sparshastu kaunteya shita ushna sukha dukkhada. Therefore, you should always expect that as soon as sukha is there, dukkha will also come. That adjustment in your expectation will give you the power to tolerate. Oh, you have been honored, then dishonor will also come. Oh, you know, you had a big feast. You liked it. Okay, fasting day will also come. Both will come, one after another. So we cannot just expect everything the way we want. And so he says that you have a heritage of responsibility from your father's side and your mother's side. Your mother, Kunti, she's the embodiment of tolerance. How much she tolerated. If she could tolerate so much, why can't you? And then from the father's side, you know, your ancestry has Bharat Maharaj, who was an embodiment of tolerance. So you are Bharata, so you better tolerate this. And the most hope-giving word, Arjuna, is Agama Apayino Anitya. When you focus on this word, Anitya, then you know that as soon as one has come, other will also come. Anitya. Then tantitiksha subharata. Then you will get the power to tolerate. Like that. So then 4.42. Tasmat ajnana sambhutam hrittam jnanasinatmanah chitvainam samshayam yogam atishto tishta bharata. So here he is referring to Arjuna as atishto tishta bharata. You are a kshatriya, you are a descendant of King Bharata, you are a man of action. And therefore, you are supposed to have wisdom, courage and patience. A kshatriya warrior is supposed to have all the three. Therefore, you are Bharata, you are a descendant of the great, powerful kshatriya warrior Bharata. So you have to have wisdom, you have to have courage, you have to have patience. And therefore, tasmat ajnana. So you actually destroy this hesitation and doubt which is arising out of ignorance. And so, chitvainam samshayam, cut through and get up and fight. Like that. So then, the next, he is described as Bharata Rishabha. Tasmatvam indriyanyadau niyamya Bharata Rishabha vapmanam prajahihyenam jnana vijnana nashanam. So here he is in the third chapter, after having described about lust and how to overcome lust in response to Arjuna's question. Athakena prayuktoyam papam charati purusham. Anichchan, I do not like, I do not want. Still, it looks like some force is overpowering me. Baladiva. So then he explains all about lust. And then he concludes by saying, therefore Arjuna, indriyanyadav, at the very beginning, do not allow this lust. When it is at the stage of a spark, extinguish it. Otherwise it will become a towering inferno and it will completely overwhelm you. Niyamya Bharatarshava. So he's saying that you have a praiseworthy name and you are Bharatarshava because in the past also you have demonstrated your ability to control your senses in all kinds of provoking situations. And therefore, you have sufficient experience of spiritual bliss. Because you have sufficient experience of spiritual bliss, you will not be attracted to desires which will simply favor the lust. And therefore, Krishna has various energies, and in 10th canto there is a whole list of 16 energies described. One of the energies of Krishna is the energy of renunciation. Right? One of the energies, potencies. One of the potencies of Krishna is renunciation. But what is the Sanskrit name for the potency of renunciation? Sanskrit for potency of renunciation or energy of renunciation is tushti. That renunciation potency is described as tushti. So literally tushti means satisfaction, which shows that satisfaction is the basis for renouncing other engagements and other proclivities which may be connected to lusty desires. So therefore here he is saying, Bharatarshabha, you are best, you know, amongst those who have experienced transcendental bliss, and so you will not be attracted and enchanted to lust. So therefore, here Bharatarshabha refers to Arjuna as self-controlled. I have confidence that you, Arjuna, are self-controlled. You won't be provoked by lust. Balam balavatam chaham kamaraga vivarjitam dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi Bharatarshabha. So here he is saying that amongst the powers, balam balavatam chaham kama raga vivarjitam, sex life, which is non-different from religious principles, is me. So he is saying that Arjuna, because you have controlled your sex desire, and there are examples in the past where Urvashi tried to bewilder you, but you could resist the temptation even of one of the most enchanting ladies in the whole universe, Urvashi. And therefore, kamosmi Bharatarshabha. You have the ability to appreciate and understand what is sex desire, which is as per religious principles, which is under control and not one which overwhelms you. Therefore, you are Bharatarshabha, which means, Arjuna, you are exemplary. You are exemplary. And then next one describes, Lobha pravrtir arambha karmanam ashamaspriha rajasiyetani jayante vivriddhe Bharatarshabha. So here, the 14th chapter describes the various qualities of Rajogun. Lobha, pravrtir, greed, karmanam ashama, you know, intense activities to fulfill desires, all are symptoms of mode of passion. But rajasi etani jayante vivriddhe Bharatarshabha. But my dear Arjuna, don't worry. You are not going to be subjected to this because you are the best amongst those in the Bharata dynasty. You are free from greed and you are free from other symptoms of mode of passion. And therefore you are not under the influence. So therefore he is called as Bharata Rishabha. Like that. So therefore, all of these three contexts of the word Bharata Rishabha is very significant. Sense controlled, exemplary, and you know, he is free from influence of the mode of passion. And so Arjuna was not only very competent, but he had a very ideal character also. And in the modern education system, we find that a lot of emphasis is given primarily to competence and not much to character. And so Srila Prabhupada wanted this message of Gita to be spread so that people also integrate a proper character and transformation of their heart along with their career path. Like I was distributing, you know, books in the train many years ago in the local trains, and it was discovered by Braj Bihari Prabhu. He is the founder of local train Gita distribution, not on the platform, in the train. We had reached till the platform and outside, but inside the train, then he cracked open. Okay, we can also distribute inside. So, you know, a lot of devotees would go out, Jai Shri Srinatha Gopinath Ji ki. So I was distributing books to one gentleman, and then he asked me, you know, you're distributing books to maintain yourself? Like you are also like another hawker? You're maintaining yourself and this is... I said, no, actually, I'm coming from educated background only. I'm from IIT. So he said, what? You're from IIT? I'm a filmmaker. I'm recently making a film on what all people do to enter IIT. And you passed out from IIT and you're, you know, like a hawker, you're distributing this book. I said, this is not book, this is Bhagavad Gita. It's a knowledge which will change your whole life, transform your life. So I said, where are you from? He said, I'm from Pune. I said, oh, my friend is from Pune. His name is Radhesham Prabhu. He's also from IIT. And he said, he's also like you. I said, yeah. Not like me, he's more advanced than me. So he said, oh my God, I think I have to make one more film after I complete this film. Because this film is what all people do to enter IIT. My second film will what all people do after leaving IIT. So this is a very important principle, that some forum where people actually do get connected to transcendental knowledge, and that can transform their entire perspective of how they are performing their particular occupation. So Arjuna was a very powerful Kshatriya, but Krishna is glorifying him in all these verses, not for his Kshatriya skill, not for his Kshatriya competence, but for his character, for his impeccable character. Then next, Arjuna is being glorified by Krishna. So both are glorifying each other. So it is not that Krishna is sitting and saying, Arjuna, agla naam bolo. Next. Are ye chapter mein jyada bola nahi aur bolo. So Arjuna is glorifying Krishna, and then Krishna is also glorifying Arjuna. So it's like a sankirtan. They are actually glorifying each other due to great mutual appreciation. Pancha janyam rishi kesho devadattam dhananjaya paundram dadmau mahashankam bhima karma brakodaraha. So here Krishna is referring, or here Arjuna is being referred to as Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya means one who helped the brother get more wealth for the Rajasuya Yajna. This is the direct meaning here. Bhima Karma, this is like a direct description given by Sanjay. So it is not like Krishna speaking this. So therefore, you know, this is the direct meaning of Dhananjaya. Then next one. Durena hyavaram karma buddhi yoga dhananjaya buddhau sharam anvicha kripanaha phalahetavaha. So now Krishna is telling Arjuna, perform your duty without attachment. Buddhau sharanamanvichya kripana phalahetava. Those who are kripana, miserly, they are always seeking the fruit and the result of their action. My dear Arjuna, you are Dhananjay. You are overflowing with wealth. You are super rich. You should not behave like miserly. And you should not be attached to the results of your work. Atha chittam samadhatum nashaknoshi mayisthiram abhyasa yoge natato mamichhaptum dhananjaya. O Arjuna, you are Dhananjay. In the past, you have conquered over many enemies, defeated enemies, plundered their treasury and captured their wealth. Now it is time for you to attack the enemy of the mind. Plunder away all the anarthas, take it away, and then capture the wealth of meditation. Capture the wealth of meditation and be absorbed in thoughts of me. That is Arjuna's name as Dhananjaya. Kachit etat shrutam partha tvayaika grena chetasa kachit agyana sammoha pranashtaste Dhananjaya. And towards the end, Krishna is asking Arjuna, you know, I have spoken so much to you, you have been hearing. Because when someone is sitting or and hearing, you don't really know whether he has understood or not, whether he agrees with us or not, whether he wants to follow or not. Kachit etat shrutam partha tvaya ekagrena chetasa. Have you heard with absorption, with one-pointed attention? Kachit agyana sammoha. Has the agyana gone? Has the bewilderment due to agyana gone? Pranashtaste Dhananjaya. So therefore Krishna is asking, have you grasped the wealth of knowledge with a concentrated mind? Have you grasped that wealth of knowledge? You are Dhananjaya, one who conquers the wealth. So have you grasped this wealth of knowledge? So this is a beautiful description of Arjuna as Dhananjaya. Then another word which Arjuna uses for Krishna is Govinda. Kim no rajena Govinda, kim bhogair jivitenava, yesham arthe kankshitam no rajyam bhoga sukhanicha. So here Krishna is being referred to as Govinda. So Govinda means one who gives pleasure to our senses. So Arjuna is saying, you're engaging me in this battle, you're supposed to be giving pleasure to my senses. By doing this, I'm going to be experiencing pain. Remember your name, you're Govinda. So Krishna is the object of pleasure of the cows, senses and earth. So Prabhupada writes in the purport, Arjuna is thinking that this is what will please his senses. But actually when he pleases Rishikesha, Krishna's senses, then one's senses will be satisfied. The next verse where Arjuna is in a state of bewilderment and he surrenders completely. Sanjaya uvacha eva muktva Rishikesham gudakesha parantapa nayotsya iti govindam uktva tushnim babhuvaha. So nayotsya iti govindam, I will not fight, Arjuna says. And he calls him nayotsya iti govindam uktva tushnim. So right now I am in great distress. Right now I am totally frustrated. I am experiencing great anxiety. My dear Lord, you are Govinda, one who relieved the distress of Mother Earth. You picked up Mother Earth from the ocean in the form of Varahadev and brought it back and destroyed Hiranyaksha. And therefore, O Govinda, just like you relieve the distress of Mother Earth, like that you relieve my distress also and give pleasure to my senses. Protect your devotee. Protect my senses. So therefore he is praying and begging Krishna to relieve him. Then another very interesting name which Arjuna is called by is Gudakesha. Eva mukto rishi kesho gudakeshena bharata senayor ubayor madhye sthapayitva rathottamam. So having spoken this, Gudakeshena Bharata. So Rishikesh speaks this to Gudakesh, to Arjuna. Senayor ubhayor madhye. So Arjuna is telling, please place my chariot between the two armies. So here, Guraka refers to sleep and ignorance. So here, Arjuna is referred to someone who was beyond ignorance, who was beyond sleep, who was so skillful and so absorbed, so dedicated, so committed that all night he would not sleep. Because Dronacharya had given instruction, never feed Arjuna any food in the dark. So as Arjuna was eating once, there was a lamp which was glowing nearby. A gust of wind blew and that flame got extinguished and it was dark. It was pitch dark and Arjuna continued eating. And Arjuna started thinking. Just see the difference between Arjuna's thinking and our thinking. Arjuna started thinking, you know, if it becomes dark and then we are in that situation, we may think, "Arey, gulab jamun dikh nahi raha kahan pe hai? Kahan gayab ho gaya plate mein? Kidhar gaya? Kahin juice gir na chahe haath se?" So we are thinking, okay, what will happen now? So Arjuna's thinking, it is completely dark, still I am able to eat. My hand is finding the mark inside the mouth in the dark. If I can eat in the dark, why can't I practice archery in the dark? Why do I have to stop practicing archery at night? It is because I am not sincere. It is because I am lazy. It is because I am fallen. Because I am leisure seeking. I am not taking Dronacharya's instruction seriously enough. I am becoming too complacent. And therefore, I will now change my schedule. I will practice in the day and I will practice at night. I will practice day and night. So therefore Arjuna is known as Gudakesha, one who conquered over sleep. And it was not that Dronacharya told him. The night also you start. And Arjuna is reluctantly looking at him with anger and saying, "Kasrat kara raha hai humko raat ko." No, he was doing it on his own. So he had conquered sleep. Right? And it was not that he was like struggling, yawning all night and his arrows are going here and there because he's just about to sleep and in between puts his head on the bow for some time on Gandiva, uses it as pillow, then gets up again. Tells Nakul Sahadeva, "Wake me up after 1 hour. I'm taking some rest." And then in the morning the arrows are all over the place. You know, sometimes while studying in the afternoon, after lunch, I have experience. You know, your head starts rolling and you're taking notes and then you fall asleep and all kinds of designs come in the notes. Because we have no control over our sleep. And this was night, not afternoon, it was at night. So here, Arjuna has been referred to as one who conquered over such sleep and ignorance, who was so committed, who had such powers of determination. But please know that Krishna has the exact plan to humble each one of us in spite of all the commitment, all the determination, all the hard work we can possibly do, and all the skills and all the track record of successes, still something will manifest which will make one totally bewildered. Senayor ubhayor madhye ratham sthapay. So Arjuna is thinking, oh, like another battle. Krishna, bring this chariot in between the two. So for Arjuna, it is like a regular, you know, day. No big deal. Right? For him, it is like business as usual. But Krishna has something in store. On a regular day, something irregular will happen. So therefore, this shows that even someone who is so qualified in terms of abilities to conquer his senses and control his habits, don't think just a regulated lifestyle is an insurance and indemnity against confusion. It can come anytime. Be ready. Not today. Today we'll meditate on the Bhagavad Gita. So Chakravarti Pad also gives a beautiful meaning. Guda and Akesha. And he says, Guda he refers to as molasses. From sugar, it becomes juice. So, he relishes the exchange with his devotees, and he is going to just begin a sweet exchange of relish with Arjuna. So as Arjuna is telling him, Senayor ubhayor madhye sthapetva rathottamam guda keshena. So Krishna is just about to begin a sweet exchange of love with Arjuna. First, by following his order as a chariot driver, submitting to his orders, becoming his servant, and then becoming the servant of his life's journey and taking the reins of his life and leading him on the right track. So therefore, Krishna is good. Arjuna is referred to as Guda Kesha. Also, 10.20 refers to Guda Kesha. Aham Atma Guda Kesha Sarva Bhutashayasthita Aham Madhischa Madhyamcha Bhutanamanta Evacha. So, those who are sleeping, they're not possible to understand how the Supreme Personality of Godhead manifests in the material and the spiritual world. Because Arjuna is above such darkness, because you're above such darkness, I can explain things to you about my opulences. Because when people are completely intoxicated by the thoughts of their own opulences, I cannot explain about my opulences. They are not in a mood to hear. They are asleep to my opulences. They are awake to their own glories, to their own powers, to their own skills. They won't take interest in what I am trying to say. Because you are above such ignorance, you are Guda Kesha. Sarva bhutashayasthita aham adischa madhyamcha bhutanam anta evacha. How I am the beginning, middle and the end. I am going to start describing all my opulences and you can capture it because you are awake, you are alert to hear my glories. You are interested and absorbed to know how Krishna is great. So that is another meaning of Guda Kesha, like that. Next, Rishikesha. Panchajanyam Rishikesho Devadattam Dhananjaya Paundram Dadmau Mahashankham Bhima Karma Brikodara. So here, again, Krishna is being described as Rishikesha, Lord of everyone's senses. So Chakravarti Pad describes that this means Krishna is personally present to control Arjuna's senses and take him to victory. That's his confidence. That's his commitment. Eva mukto rishi kesho guda keshe na bharata senayor bhayor madhye sthapayatva rathottamam. So in the same verse which we just described, Arjuna, Sanjay is referring to Krishna as Rishikesha. So he's saying that Prabhupada says that the director of senses and mind, Krishna could understand Arjuna's mind in placing because he wanted to observe. He wanted to observe the situation by his own paradigm, based on his own understanding, from his own perspective. And therefore, Krishna could appreciate this. And Chakravarti Pad explains that actually, Krishna is the controller of senses, but out of love for his devotees, Krishna comes under the control of his devotees' love. Because of love for his devotees. So therefore this here, Rishikesha also means Krishna comes under the control of his devotees' love. Then we have 2.9 again. Sanjaya uvacha eva muktva rishikesham gudakesha parantapa nayotsya iti govindam uktva tushnim babhuvaha. So Sanjay is indicating to Dhritarashtra, because Dhritarashtra is wanting to know, you know, what will happen, what will happen. So he's saying that don't worry. Arjuna at this point appears to be crestfallen, devoid of all hope and desire to fight. But Krishna, being the controller of the senses, will convince Arjuna to fight. And once Krishna convinces Arjuna to fight, the victory of the Pandavas is guaranteed. And the failure, defeat and the destruction of your sons is also guaranteed. So through that one word, Rishikesham, how many things, you know, Sanjay is conveying. So that is the power of Sanskrit and that is the power of Shastra, that through one word, so many meanings are conveyed. Right? And so here, in the 11th chapter, another way in which Arjuna refers to Krishna as Rishikesha. Arjuna uvacha sthane Rishikesha tava prakirtya jagat prahrishyat anurajyate cha rakshamsi bhitani disho dravanti sarve namasyanti cha siddha sanghah. So here it is described by Arjuna that, oh, rakshansi bhitani dishodravanti sarve. I see all the demigods from all directions worshipping you, glorifying you. And so he calls him Rishikesha tava prakirtya. So therefore Chakravarti Pad says that you direct the senses of your devotees towards you and not away from you. Right? Rakshamsi bhitani dishodravanti sarve namasyanti cha siddha sanghaha. So there are demons who try to escape your clutches. There are demigods who come and take your shelter. But you being Rishikesh, you always bring the devotees close to your lotus feet and allow them to serve you because you are Rishikesha. You direct the senses of the devotees towards yourself like that. So therefore, this is a description of Rishikesha, how Krishna, he actually enlivens our senses, and he is the lord of the senses. And so sadhana bhakti is the process of gradually going through all the various steps which will then ignite the real devotional service within our heart. Right, one newly married girl, they had just organized the marriage, and she came along with her husband, and she was meeting Prabhupada. And so Prabhupada suddenly asked her, "Who do you love more, Krishna or your husband?" It's a very, loaded question. And she was just newly married. And you have to be more careful in a new relationship. So suddenly this girl started crying. So Prabhupada got bewildered. Hey, did I ask such a dangerous question? I just asked, whom do you love more? Like jokingly, Krishna or your husband? She was crying and Prabhupada said, what happened? She said, neither. Because at this stage, I don't know him beyond few days. And I'm chanting, I'm not having taste for holy name. I'm just doing my duty. So Prabhupada said, don't worry. By the practice, gradually the feelings will arise. So Krishna is the Lord of the senses. When we keep our senses engaged in Krishna's service, gradually all those emotions also arise. So therefore, Jiva Goswami Pad explains in a beautiful verse, in a Paramatma Sandarbha, Upakramo Upasamharo Abhyasa Apurvata Phalam Arthavada Upapatticha Lingam Tatparna Nirnaya. He says, how do you understand the intention of an author? The intention of an author is established by six things. And he says, based on these six, we can appreciate, that in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna's intention is to give us bhakti. So what is the first symptom? The first symptom is called upakrama. What is the beginning? And upasamhara and the conclusion must match. So Arjuna says, dharma sammuda cheta. And Krishna says, sarva dharman parityaj. So Krishna has given solution to Arjuna for his dharma sammuda. All different dharmas are there. Okay, give them up and follow me. So bhakti, mamekam sharanam raja. Devotional service is established. Third principle is abhyasa. Upakramo upasamhara abhyasa. Abhyasa means that which is repeated the most. What is repeated often is bhakti. Right? We have Krishna explaining in the second chapter, 2.61, 7.1, Maya Sakta Manapartha Yogam Yunyan Madashre, 8.14, Ananya Cheta Satam Yomam Smarati. Then we have 9.22, Ananya Chintayantomam. So many examples are there that Krishna is repeating devotional service, the glories of bhakti. Then fourth principle is apurvata phalam. There is something which is given extraordinary claims, unique to that particular literature and not found anywhere else. So what are some of the extraordinary and unique claims which Krishna is making? It is with respect to bhakti. Right? Yoga kshemam vahamyaham. Anyone who becomes my devotee, I personally come. I supply resources. I not only supply resources, I supply intelligence also. Dadami buddhi yogam tam. I not only supply intelligence, I also remove his ignorance. Nashayami atma bhavastho. Jnana deepena bhasvata. And in this way, Krishna, with respect to devotional service, makes extraordinary claims, unique situations, which is only there for this particular yogi. One who is a bhakti yogi. And that facility he is not opening up for other yogis. So that is called as after abhyasa, apurvata phalam. Apurvata phalam means a certain kind of fruit or result which is not seen in other paths. Then arthavada means two things. Arthavada basically means, what is the author's own declaration? What is the author's own declaration in terms of number one, result, and number two, glorification? So repeatedly, Krishna explains that the result of bhakti is most easily obtained. Mami partha vipashita tepi syu papa yonaya striyo vaishya tatashudra tepi yanti paramgatim. That anyone who worships me, even if they are highly unqualified, they will attain me without fail. He's declaring from his own side. And then he says in the 56th verse, Sarva Karmani. Kurvan Atmat Mat Prasadat Shashvatam Padam. In the 56th verse of the 18th chapter, Krishna says that if one is engaged in other activities also, but if he is constantly thinking of me, still he will attain me. So Krishna is offering the special result to those who practice bhakti. And then he is glorifying bhakti specifically. Right? 6.47. Yoginam api sarvesham madgatin antaratmana. Atma means body. Atma means mind. Atma means intelligence. Atma can mean ego identity. Atma is all these things. But antaratma means only one thing. Soul. Antaratmana. When you perform bhakti with the body, when you perform activity, connect with Krishna using body and senses, karma yoga. Using your, you know, knowledge, using mind, jnana yoga. Using intelligence, ashtanga yoga. But the vehicle which is used for connecting, using the soul, that is bhakti yoga. When the soul is used as the vehicle to connect with the Lord, antaratmana. So therefore, special glorification and results are offered. And so, arthavado upapatticha lingam tatparana nirnaya. Lingam tatparya nirnaya. So, sixth is upapatti or logic or arguments in favor of devotional service to establish that as superior to other things. So therefore, upapatti basically means logical arguments in favor of a certain activity like that. So therefore, you know, patram pushpam phalam toyam yomi bhaktya prayachati tadaham bhakti vrtam. Krishna is giving logic, reason why you must practice devotional service. How it is so easy, why you can easily connect with me. So many verses here in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita describe this. So therefore, various yoga processes are described in the Gita, but the conclusion is that the bhakti is something which I am really hankering for to taste from every jiva. And therefore, Krishna establishes yoga as bhakti yoga. And so, what began as Arjuna's vishada, that vishada brought him closer to Krishna. And then a whole dialogue ensued between Krishna and Arjuna. And as a result of that dialogue, which was based on the platform of love and affection, it was on the basis of trust mutually between both the speaker and the hearer, then Krishna finally convinces Arjuna to take shelter of bhakti, abandon all other identities, and then based on his swarupa, which will take him above his swadharma, above his swabhava, and understanding his swarupa, he'll be able to be more effective in his swadharma and be able to experience his swabhava in a much more positive manner. With that understanding of swarupa, Krishna speaks the entire Bhagavad Gita. And Sanjay concludes by saying, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna Tatra Partho Dhanurdhara Tatra Shrir Vijayo Bhutir Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama. And if one actually hears and applies the Gita in his life, wherever Krishna is, the revealer of the real knowledge, and wherever Arjuna is, the humble, enthusiastic seeker of that knowledge, the combination of the two will only create illumination, victory, prosperity, and glory, and nothing else. And that's the real glory and fortune of the soul in its journey of millions of lifetimes, where in the state of despair and dejection, rather than taking shelter of all kinds of abominable habits and sinking into the mode of ignorance, one takes shelter of the nectar of the sound vibration which comes from Krishna's lotus mouth and rises above the modes of nature and goes back home, back to Godhead. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.